In the 1970s, Afghanistan became a focus for superpower rivalry. Close to the Persian Gulf's oil and the Indian Ocean ports, it bordered Iran in the west and Pakistan in the south and east. In the north, it shared a border with the Muslims of the Soviet Union's Central Asian republics. To Moscow, a friendly Afghanistan was vital. Kabul, Afghanistan, April 1978. A military coup brings a left-wing regime to power. Soviet cameras portray it as a romantic, popular revolution. Crowds were organized to celebrate the change of power. Nur Mohammad Taraki, Afghanistan's new leader, looked to the Soviet Union for support. Moscow sent hundreds of Soviet advisors to advance socialism.
The vast majority of Afghan people had no jobs. Afghanistan was an agricultural country. We thought it was best to introduce land reforms and give land to the landless. It would enable them to work their own land and raise their standard of living.
The left-wing regime set about reforming Afghanistan by decree. Land was taken from large owners and handed to the peasants who worked it. Women were encouraged to stop wearing veils and were put into literacy classes alongside men. In the countryside, the reforms were seen to threaten ancient customs and the authority of the Islamic priests, the mullahs.
The communists were trying to change the law of God. They wanted to destroy Islamic traditions, to rid Afghanistan of poverty and make everyone equal. This is against the law of Islam. God has decided who is rich and who is poor. It can't be changed by communists. It's beyond imagination.
To counter communist efforts to spread their new doctrine, opponents of the reforms burnt down schools and universities. Thousands of Afghans fled to Pakistan to avoid the revolutionary turmoil. Resistance was growing throughout the country.
Brezhnev and the Politburo tried to talk sense into Kabul. We couldn't understand how they could build socialism in just 5 years. We said, you can't do that. We've been building socialism for 60 years and we're still not finished. But they thought it was us that had got it wrong. Naivety was coming out of their every orifice. It was in their every word.
In neighboring Iran, crowds joined the call of the Afghan resistance for a jihad, or holy war, against the godless communists. Other Islamic countries took up the cry. In Washington, National Security Advisor Zbigniew Brzezinski was convinced the left-wing regime in Afghanistan was a major threat.
Yeah, and that will deal first with Iran, then with Afghanistan and the regional implications.
Brzezinski told President Carter that Moscow might use the Afghan crisis to move south and seize the oil of the Persian Gulf.
Well, I have essentially four items I'd like to do.
You. Brzezinski's fears for the stability of the region gained weight when mass demonstrations in Tehran led to the overthrow of the Shah of Iran. The Shah's fall lost America its most important ally in the region.
We were faced with the possibility that one way or another, before too long, we may have either a hostile Iran on the northern shore of the Persian Gulf facing us, or we might even have the Soviets there.
The Islamic groups fighting the communists received covert American aid for the first time in July 1979. President Carter began by sending communications equipment. The rebels called themselves the Mujahideen, the soldiers of God. They were mostly peasants, organized by village mullahs and landowners. Many of their weapons were captured from the communist regime. From the refugee camps in Pakistan, recruits for the jihad walked for days across the mountains to reach the fighting. Ranged against the Mujahideen was a mechanized, Soviet-trained Afghan army. Soviet film depicted a highly motivated fighting force. In fact, each month, thousands of soldiers deserted. Kabul pleaded with Moscow to send Soviet troops. In the Kremlin, Soviet leaders repeatedly met to discuss the Afghan crisis. After mobs massacred Soviet advisors and their families in Herat, Kabul's request for Soviet troops moved up the agenda.
The Afghans wanted us to introduce a limited contingent of Soviet troops to guard military bases. They just couldn't cope with the Mujahideen themselves. At first they spoke about a battalion, then about a brigade. They kept insisting and pushing for Soviet troops, but we kept refusing and refusing and refusing.
President Taraki had an apparently devoted prime minister, Hafizullah Amin. Amin was the regime's strongman. In spite of the unrest, he was determined to drive on with the reforms. Amin launched a campaign of terror. He had opponents arrested and shot.
I said to Amin that his policies were too harsh, that they were turning the Muslim population against him, like the land reforms, which did not take into account Afghan traditions. But he used to reply, "Did Stalin make the revolution in white gloves?"
Afghan President Taraki flew to Moscow to discuss with Soviet leader Leonid Brezhnev how to curb Amin's excesses. They decided to oust him, hoping the Kabul government could get popular support by slowing the reforms and ending the terror. Moscow's secret plans leaked out. When President Taraki returned to Kabul, Amin had him seized and executed. Amin realized the Soviets wanted him out. He began to seek better ties with the West. The KGB even imagined Amin might be a CIA agent.
Andropov, the head of the KGB, became very concerned about Amin flirting with the Americans. Andropov felt that if we didn't introduce Soviet troops, Amin would claim that Moscow hadn't fulfilled its obligations. He would then turn to the Americans for help, and they would put their own troops in.
In Moscow, the arguments were mounting in favor of using an invasion to remove Amin. In the past, Soviet military action to topple troublesome foreign leaders had worked in Hungary and Czechoslovakia.